Thank you. come to you as a church right now, as a family. We just want to thank you for what you're about to do in our lives. We call it out in faith that we know that you'll show up for us and do something amazing. I thank you that when things get tough, you give us strength to go on. Remove our dependencies on anything else that we put in place of you, God. Draw us back to you as our source of strength and our source of joy, our source of direction and purpose. Father, when I listen to this song, that's what I think of. I think of all the things that I put in place of you. And this song says, Christ is enough. God, give us your eyes to see the parts of our lives that need to be cleaned out and replaced with you. Give us strength to tear apart the parts of ourselves that aren't working, that aren't like you. Give us foresight to see that it's worth it. You're going to have to tear yourself down to build yourself back up in Jesus' image. There's some part of you, of every one of us, that's not the way God intended. And it's going to hurt to tear that apart. That's not going to be easy. That's going to be a difficult process. It's going to be rough. But God is going to give us the foresight to do like Romans 12:2 says, to renew our minds to be more like him. That we might not be lost in the world and conforming to their ways, but that we would set a better standard of living closer to the Father. Amen?
Amen.
Don't be afraid of pain. Pain is inevitable. Jesus said the storms will come, and that's rough stuff. It kind of sucks to have a guarantee of pain, but there's also a guarantee of victory on the other side. Don't let the pain blind you to the victory. Amen? Let's sing this song. I just want you to keep that in mind, that maybe you're going through a painful time right now, and what God is trying to show you through this song is that he's enough. It's not that the pain is going to go away, but the reward on the other side is going to be so much richer. That's good. Someone write that down. I want that after service. Let's sing.
Christ is my reward. Oh, my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that can ever satisfy.
Enough.
decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
There is a video. Well, today is Memorial Day, as we all know, and so we would like to do a tribute to our veterans. So let's get that. We have a video for you, so let's watch that video. Served in the military and put on their uniform to serve us in this country and to serve for our freedom. And many of them didn't get to take it off, didn't get to take that uniform off. And they sacrificed their lives for us. And so let's just pray. I want to pray. I know there's some here that you may be remembering someone that gave their lives for your freedom. And you could be grieving or you know someone that's grieving, so let's just pray for those people. Father, we just thank you. Father, we thank you. First of all, we thank you for Jesus, who did the ultimate sacrifice for us, Lord God. But Father, I thank you for those, Lord God, that sacrificed their lives for us, for our freedom, Father, for this country, Lord God. Father, I thank you for this country, Lord God. We thank you for the United States. We thank you, Lord God, that you truly do bless America, Lord God. And we ask you that you continue to bless. Father, I pray for those, Lord God, that have lost loved ones or knows others that have lost them. Father, I pray that your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, would be with them this weekend, Lord God, as some are visiting gravesides. And Father, that your Spirit would comfort them, for the Holy Spirit is the great comforter. Yeah. And Father, we thank you. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that comes and just puts that healing salve on our hearts, Lord God, and just give people peace, Lord God, that Father, that for those that we know, Lord God, help us to be careful with our words and just to give comfort and just acknowledge their loss, Lord God. And I just thank you for that, Lord God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We have some connection news. Let's go move on with that. Today is step four of the growth track. This is a great opportunity. This isn't the time to come and the first time. You know, we ask that you at least go to 1, 2, and 3 before you come into step four. This is a time when you can connect with a team. And it's also a time that we also do our small group training. So if you haven't done that, it's class is only 40 minutes. It's a great opportunity to grow and mature. And it's actually just a really good and uplifting class and gives you some directions on just on leading a group. And it's just very good. It's just all of them are great. So, and then speaking of small groups, we have small group signups in the back. I'm not going to go over them individually, But I'm just telling you, get in the group, get in the group, get in that group. You're going to find freedom in that group. And, you know, this is our summer series, so it's like the best time to go. It's 6 weeks. And even if you can't make it to all of them, only if it's one or two, get in a group and come and just see how things work and get connected with people. Let people in your life and watch yourself grow and mature. It'll happen. I'm telling you, it will. Okay, so we're going to introduce a new series. Pastor's doing a new series, and we have a video to kick that off.
Get us in the mood for what we're going to be proceeding with over the next few weeks. You may or may not realize this, but the Lord has been stretching me so much this year and making me so uncomfortable in so many ways. And I figure, hey, if he's doing it to me, he's either probably doing it to you, or at least I want to alert you to it so you guys are aware of what's going on. It's kind of an exciting topic. Like I said, he's been working on it. I think last week I confessed to you all. Don't you love it when I confess things to you?
Yeah.
James 5:16 says, confess your faults one to another, and there will be healing. Yeah. And I promised, I told you, you know, if you get a hug from me, well, you know it's God. Because it's like, hugs are tough for me. I mean, it's just, I don't know why they are. I'm sure I got hugged as a kid. But for some reason, it's just that closeness. It's something similar. Some of you are getting more hugs. Not because I want to, but it's because I know the Lord wants to do something in me. So I can say, just figure, it's just the Lord stretching pastor, making him more uncomfortable so he can do more of what he wants to do in me and in you. And so some of you are just natural huggers, you know, I just get so, I can't say jealous, because that's I don't want to be jealous, but I watch some of you guys, you're just like, oh, you're just like that, you know, I'm working on. Okay, so we're talking about being uncomfortable, and I got a lot to share before we get into the message, and this will go on for several weeks, just because, like I said, I got a lot to talk about, because that's like my middle name, is Jerry Uncomfortable Wagoner. Okay, I may not look like it, because actually when I'm in the pulpit, this is like my most comfortable spot in the world. I mean, it's like, throughout my week, I mean, I was even nervous before about sitting there. But the minute I get up here, it's like, oh, okay, here I am. Lord, I was born to do this. I can do it. And so I'm okay. But I have a lot of uncomfortable situations in my life. And I allow people to speak into my life, which is uncomfortable. But I'm learning after almost 60 years that that's what we need to do. And so it's a big step. And so I'm hoping today that I'll share with you in a positive way, even though I was kind of a boom, boom, boom. I mean, that was a heavy intro. I found that clip, and it's like, oh yeah, Lord, this is perfect. And I didn't make that myself. It was pre-made, obviously, because it was good. I'm still learning those sorts of things, all right? I'm working on it. But anyway, let's just back the truck up here a minute and just let you know. Now I felt uncomfortable, all right? So now the uncomfortableness on me. If you guys are experiencing uncomfortableness, I got good news for you. The Word has a lot to say about it. God has a lot to say about it. And it's so easy to blame the devil. I love to blame the devil on stuff. But a lot of times, God just lets us go through a lot of uncomfortable situations. And it does something. And so that's kind of the theme of this. And I'm just believing today as we share and walk through this that it'll mean something to you. If you have your Bible app, if you go to the events section, Terrence has preloaded the notes today. So pull up your Bible app and hit events. And you'll see, because you're here and you have your GPS on, the first thing up there will be Connection Church. You can fill in your notes along the way. You can use the fill-in sheet that I've given you, or you can just memorize what's in your head, whatever works best for you. Amen. But I want this to make a difference in us today. Last Sunday, I'm going to tell you a story first. Last Sunday, after church, I had some things to take care of, but my grandson Peyton was having a baseball tournament. And you all know, I mean, I'm just so open with you guys. I mean, me in sports, I know nothing. I'm just like, I just don't. It's just not one of the things I understand. It's not one of the things that I was ever involved with as a kid or but my grandkids seem to like they're taking off with it. And it's awesome. And so I was at this. I couldn't go during the day, but about four or five in the afternoon, I made it over to Gladstone, and he was playing, and I got this report from my son that it's just an awesome day. I mean, their team was winning. They were doing really well, but they only lost to one team, and the one team that they lost to was a traveling team. Right? And so it's a traveling team of the best of the best of the best. And again, I don't know nothing about baseball, but apparently these are like, how old is Peyton? 10. Apparently there was 10-year-olds. He was throwing the ball at 70 miles an hour. So I think that's pretty fast, all right? And because I was watching it, it's just like, so what was happening was the kids were, they had a great day, but they were exhausted. It was the end of the day. And it was kind of warm, just, you know, 4 or 5 in the afternoon. And they knew they'd lost once during that day to that team. So it was in their head that they're pretty unbeatable. I mean, they're just their level of playing was really high. So the boys were very uncomfortable, all right, for a lot of different reasons. And so the game started, and I watched all the boys on the team went out there and get struck out, you know. And so it was moving pretty quick because they would do that. And but what I was amazed with was the coach. I was behind the dugout so I could listen and watch. Because these boys, you know, they're like, you know, it's like they knew what was coming. They knew that they were going to be, in a way, humiliated. You know, everyone's there watching, and they knew these guys were way above their league. And that coach, he would just build them up. He says, I know this is hard. He says, but this is what we're here for. This is going to make us better. Going through this, walking through this, having a good idea, fighting the fight, not giving up. It's going to make us better players. And I tell you, those boys, they just get up and they go and they, you know, whatever, hit, miss, you know, hear the arrows that whoosh by them and everything, you know. But they just kept going at it. And I just got thinking, Lord, I wasn't expecting that. I wasn't expecting the Lord to speak to me through my grandson's team, through sports, which I detest, and I'm sorry. I love my kids and grandkids there, and I don't get it. And so, but then I got it. Okay, I see. Because I've seen some bad coaches, and so I'm like, it's not always the best experience for kids, but this was just, it was, and then Cindy and I were able to go Wednesday night to another game out in Canby. Same thing, we watched him, they won the game that day, but again, he was just constantly building these boys up, and just, you know, you guys can do this, and keep battling, and he'd be directing him, he'd be off third base there, you know, directing the guys, and you go here, and you go there, and get back up there, and they were just like, they were responding, because they had gone through something hard, but it had done something, and I saw a definite change from Sunday to Wednesday in those boys, and it was because they experienced something very uncomfortable, very, in a way, humiliating, very hard, and they grew from it. And I thought, Lord, isn't that just you? That's kind of you put these things in place. And there's so many people that I know, people I love. I've seen them give up on church. I've seen them give up on the Christian, the people. I've seen them give up on the Christian community. And that's what, you know, just because it gets uncomfortable, unpleasant. And I'm going to propose to you today that I don't believe God brings that. I think we bring a lot of that on our own. And there is some demonic influence sometimes. But what if God is allowing that so that we can come out on top? So we can be like those boys and just like when the next battle comes, we ain't giving up. Because I tell you, there's something the enemy wants you all to do.
Yeah.
I'm just not talking about quitting church. I'm just talking about there's people that quit to walk with the Lord. They're just like, it just seems like they go and they isolate themselves and they pull back. And I'm just telling you, it's just been grieving me for months now as I see that in our church and friends of mine as we share. It's like, we got to get a hold of this. We got to help people. It's worth it to stick it out. Amen?
Yes.
Yeah. It's worth it. Amen? All right, so let me find out where I'm in my notes somewhere. And I've got an opening scripture here. Uncomfortable. And it's found in Romans 5. So turn with me, if you will, to Romans 5, verses 3 to 4. Again, use your paper Bible, look up front, look on your notes, and follow along with me. Ready? Here we go. He says, when we run into problems and trials, anybody here ever have problems and trials?
Yeah.
All right, okay. All right, good. I'm in the right crowd, all right? it says, the word says, it tells us, we know that they'll help us develop something.
Endurance.
They help us develop endurance. And here's it. So we got problems and trials, okay? I think of problems as trials as hurt, pain, uncomfortableness, all that kind of stuff. It does something. It produces endurance. All right? It can also produce the opposite if you don't accept it, and it produces people that run. But the Bible says if we allow it, if we walk through these trials with the Lord, it says, verse 4, and endurance does something. Strengthens our character. Yeah. It's going to strengthen character, and then character does something. When you have a strengthened character, who you are, what makes you, what causes you to be who you are and make a difference and follow God's plan and purpose. When your character's strong, knowing the enemy can't take you out, it gives you a confident hope of salvation. I don't know what about you guys, but I don't want to hang around other Christians that are wishy-washy about their faith. I don't want to walk around people that are not confident in their salvation. I want to be around people that are confident in this walk, confident that God has a plan for them, confident that we are overcomers. Amen? That's what I want to be a part of, and I encourage you to be a part of that also. All right? I want strength of character. I want confidence in our walk, and I want it for you and me. Peyton's team, my grandson, it was awkward for him. It was uncomfortable, but they battled on. And I think we can learn something from this. Not just us. I think the American church, we can learn something through persevering and battling on. We're in a society, I'll get to my message here in just a moment, but we're in a society that, I have not done this, but I've seen people do it, and I see about it, and I see people making comments on it. First of all, I'm not going to blast McDonald's, but let me just talk about McDonald's for just a second. Okay. Again, nothing again. I mean, it's we're Americans. It's consumerism. It's great, whatever. And it's not fast because I've been there. It's not, say it's fast food, but it's not. And you should wait in line. But anyway, so you can go there, get your Big Mac or your, you know, double whatever, and you can do that, and you can do that. And it's fairly fast compared to a lot of places, all right? And they don't serve you, they just, you get it and you go sit down. But now there's something called Uber Eats. You don't even have to go to McDonald's anymore. It's like, now, I don't have to even talk to people, okay? I use my app, all right? I use my app, I order what I want, app Uber Eats, pick it up, somebody else delivers it to my door. I don't even have to give them the tip. I can put it on I don't even have to talk to them. I can receive it. And if I don't like the way they delivered it, I can just give them no stars or nothing. Give them a bad review. You know, I don't even have to make, again, it's just like, it's just more and more of this. It's just like, this is not healthy, people. I mean, we're avoiding confrontation. We're avoiding just common, like, you know, going and sitting down and having a meal. I know you're in a hurry sometimes, the kid's screaming in the back, and you need to go through the drive-thru, and that's okay, but I mean, it's like, there's more and more and more of this. It's like, instead of embracing what I'm going to be talking today about confrontation, conflict, and working through things, we're making it so easy in society just to back out, just to like, not get involved, just to like, you know, hide behind social media or hide behind your phone, or I'm not just blaming cell phones, I use mine all the time. I love it, but it's just more and more and more. And then we wonder why people are the way they are. We wonder why they can't have decent conversations and actually debate something instead of getting in fights. You know, you can't remember when you used to be able to give your opinion and you walked away and you still loved each other? You know what happens now if you give your opinion? I've got enemies now, but I didn't know they were my enemies, all right? They asked me and I told them, it's like, no, see no more, you know? It's just crazy. It's like, I don't think that's God's plan. I don't think that's what he wants for us. And I don't think you legislate it. I don't think you make laws. I think you have to, church, we have the ability. We have the ability through the values God gives us to not be sexist, not be racist, not be cruel, not be inhumane, but you got to be able to, you have to talk with people. And it begins, this is our school here. I believe that's part of the plan when God brings us together for church. This is why it's worth getting up and being together. I know it's not always easy. There are mornings, well, I'm lying. I always love to come to church. I just do. It's my favorite day of the week, and I can't deny that. But I know for many of you, because you've told me, there are mornings you'd love to just stay in bed or stay home, you know. I can't wait for Sunday morning church. I just can't wait for it. It's like, I'm just like, and some of you also shared that you feel the same way I do. So, somehow I'll get back to my notes here. All right. But let's just say you could pick. Let's just talk about church. Let's just talk about church, because like I say, I think we're a melting pot. We should have all kinds of people represented here. We shouldn't be of one certain slant or the other. The body of Christ is so varied and wide.
Yeah.
And you guys, you all represent that, but we want more of that. We want people to come in and show, you know, we don't care what people say. We care about what God says.
Yeah.
You don't really want my opinion anyway. We just, you know, I really don't want yours. I mean, it's not going to change me. It's what God says, all right? Yeah. And I want to be a person that just exhibits with this. And so let's just talk about church. Let's just say you could pick your dream church. Some of you probably have switched churches a time or two in your life. I've done it one, two, and then I planted this one. And so in the last 30 years, I have not done a lot of church hopping. There's good reasons to leave a church. There's reasons you have to. One of them I was fired out, so I had to leave. And so that was a good reason. But good call. But yeah. But just say that you said, I want to build a dream church. All right. We have a dream team that serves here. All our people, we don't call them volunteers. They come and they do their giftings and passions, and they give up so much of their time for you and I. But let's just say you could create your dream church, and you just think about that for just a second. I'm going to tell you about my dream church, all right? My dream church would be several things. Is they would start when I was ready and be done when I was done, all right? Just so you know, that means we'd start about 6 a.m. and be finished about 6:45. That's just kind of how I operate. I'm a morning person, and then after about 10 o'clock, I'm gone. So I'm running on God's grace now. And so we do that. In my dream church, the minute I pulled up in the parking lot, there would already be parking lot people out there with hot coffee for me. Right? They would, you know, and they would have it just how I like it. Just, I don't like sugar or cream, and I just like it hot and fresh ground and all that kind of stuff. They would have that ready. It would always be 72 degrees. It just would be, because I don't like it too hot. I don't like it too cold. I just like it 72. So my dream church, it would be 72, all right? And here's this. The worship team would only play songs that I was listening to during the week. They would know somehow those were the songs that I was listening and worshiping with, and I would just be like edified and be like, "Oh Lord, you are moving through me all week, and now I see you use me to influence the worship team." And I would just be so excited, you know. That'd be my perfect church, all right. And here's something else, because you know I'm not a big hugger, is that really nobody would say too much to me or ask my opinion. They'd just smile at me, give me my coffee, and wouldn't even and I don't like compliments. They wouldn't tell me how I look. They'd just be like, "Nice to see you." And I'd be like, "I feel so welcome in that situation," all right? And finally, in the perfect church, the pastor would preach a sermon that was exactly the way I felt. All right, it would challenge me just a hair, but it wouldn't make me feel bad about nothing. It would be just like, "Oh yes, Lord, I'm living for you." All right, that would be my dream church. And I think sadly, some of us—not you guys, because you're here and you put up with me and us, all of our dream team together—because you don't always get the songs you want, you don't always get the sermon you want, you don't always get the children's ministry you want, you don't always get that hot coffee in the parking lot. Ron, I won't have you do that. I'm thinking of Ron. I can see him out there with a cup of coffee. Okay. Because some people might be tea people, and you wouldn't know. And so, but anyway. So how about you? What's your perfect church? What's that like? And my guess is that Connection Church doesn't check all your boxes. Probably checks some of them, and probably some weeks checks more than the others. You know, because that's part of life together. That's part, and that's the excitement of living as a believer. That's the excitement, I believe, is working through stuff and challenging and that. So Romans, we'll continue with Romans 5. I did verses, I think, 3 and 4. We're going to jump down to Romans 5:5, and I think it continues with a promise. It says this, if you do, you do these things, the things I mentioned before, problems and trials lead us to endurance, and endurance leads us to character, character leads us to hope. And then he says this, and this hope will not lead to disappointment. For we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to do something, to fill our hearts with his love. Let me just stop right there and go off script for a minute. I think that's the key. See, we've been trained. We want church life. We want our Christian relationships. We want our friends. We want them to be non-confrontational. We want them to be opportunities that don't disappoint us. Don't we hate it when people let us down and disappoint us, and you know, it's frustrating, and we want that. But the Bible says this, that something's going to happen. Something's going to happen. That these things are going to, you go through these tough times and trials and tribulations, and something's going to happen that I think we miss out on. And that's the last part. When we allow ourselves to go through that, because I'll tell you, after I've had a bad situation, there's frustration in me. There's anger in me. What we do is we release ourselves to the Holy Spirit, and he promises, he says, I just fill our hearts with love. Did you ever think that confrontation, hurt, pain, irritation, if you allow God to work through you and open up to the Holy Spirit, he'll allow love to flow through you?
Yes.
I mean, it's like, if you think about it, that's God's plan. That's usually not what happens. Oh, I'm so mad at them. I'm so frustrated with them. I'm leaving. I'm out of here. I don't fit. Or whatever's happened. And people take off instead of saying, God, you're going to do something supernatural to keep me here. I'm going to have to call on you. Maybe it's at work. If the principal works everywhere.
Yeah.
Maybe it's work. Maybe it's at school. God, you're going to have to. I had so much disappointment. I've had so much frustration. Lord, if you're moving me on, you move me on. But I believe this is an opportunity for me to show love. I believe this is an opportunity for your love to pass through me in a way that I could have never done it if you hadn't brought me to this point. There's something about the journey. And in all honesty, you know, I joke with people, I'm a destination person rather than the journey. You know, I like to fly someplace, I don't like to drive. But the Lord has a different plan for it. The plan is to take us on a journey. And his destination is always awesome. It's always good, always awesome. All right? So just kind of keep that thought in mind. Allowing ourselves to be a bit uncomfortable at times will not lead to disappointment unless you let it. But rather, it opens the door for the Holy Spirit to really do something through you. That's a new concept for me. I've been looking at this year thinking, Lord, why are you letting all this icky stuff happen to me? And he's just, I just want to work for you, Jerry. I just want you to be my vessel. I just want to flow through you. And if everything's rosy, it's not going to flow through you. It's like, okay, Lord, I get it. So really, church isn't really about our preferences. It really is number one there. It really is truly about knowing God. It goes back to our first plate there. It begins there, and in a way it ends there. It comes full circle in everything we do. It's about knowing God. I think it's fun to think of the dream church. I think it's fun to think about, oh, if everything was just right, if I knew what I wanted before I asked, if they sang the songs I wanted, even though I didn't tell them, they just, you know, that kind of stuff. If they always had my coffee perfect, you know, if it never went too long, you know, just all that kind of stuff. But it's really about knowing God. That's really our first core value as a Connection Church. Know God. If you've been through our growth track, you know this, and the important thing, that has to come first. And so back in Ephesians 1:17, it says this. Asking God, the Bible puts it first, asking God, the glorious Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, to give you spiritual wisdom and insight so that you might grow in your knowledge of God. See, we don't get there and stop. We get there and continually grow in relationships, closeness, in knowledge of God. If you've stopped growing, I'm really sorry for you. Your life must be boring and full of all kinds of problems, all right? Mine's full of problems, but it's not boring. Okay? Because I got God with me. It's a much better way to live. I mean, have a choice. You're going to have problems no matter what. So you might as well have them with God. It's so much smoother. It's so much better. Jesus tells us in John 14:6, I'm telling you the truth, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Again, the only way to know God, God made it very simple, is Jesus.
Amen.
It's not being good, it's not acting right, it's not going to church, although I'm thankful you're here filling the seats. It's not. That's not it. It's Jesus, and Jesus alone. You may or may not have noticed, let's talk about worship songs. We just, Cindy and I was just really on our heart to, I love the Christian genre of music, but I finally learned, I finally learned that there's Christian music and there's Christian worship.
Yes.
Yeah. I didn't know that. I thought it was all the same. I just kind of thought it was all the same. I mean, I've always kind of depended on other worship leaders and pastors to direct me. You know, they know Jesus closer than me, I always think, and they know about worship and all that kind of stuff. And there's some great Christian music, and sometimes I'll turn on Christian radio for a few minutes. And, you know, and it's like, you know, the songs are good, and they're all about God, and it's awesome. But the songs that make a difference, the ones that help us know God, are not about how wonderful He is, although He is. It's not about how wonderful heaven is, although we mention it, and it is. But worship is about songs and praise to Jesus. Jesus. And you'll notice, you will not hardly find a song we don't do where either it's pointing to Jesus, hopefully most of them say the name Jesus. You know what I found? Some Christians are uncomfortable saying Jesus.
Wow. Which is weird.
Yeah, but it's true. Because we kind of lulled it down, you know, because we don't want to offend anybody. You know, it's just like, oh, you know, it's just, we say God, you know. But God Himself said, use my son's name.
Yes.
Everything. The devil, you know, the devil does not bow to God. He decided not to. The devil bows to Jesus.
Yes.
All right? God made it that way so we could see. You know, God, help me from this. Well, that's what He wants, but He says, I put something in place. My son, Jesus.
Yeah.
He wants us to know Him by knowing Jesus. Amen. So you'll notice, here's a couple songs that we did today, Unstoppable God. Here's the bridge for it, all right? You know our songs are planned out, right?
Yeah.
Okay, not to go with my sermon, but planned out what the Holy Spirit's doing through the worship team, through Pursuit Music, and through you as a church. Nothing shall be impossible. Nothing shall be impossible. All right. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable.
Yeah.
It's more important to me. What if we had a visitor come through, didn't know anything about the gospel, and they walked away and, oh, that was another good church because they love God and their song sounded good. But what if they heard the gospel message through a worship song for the very first time? See, that's the difference. You know, we've had some people leave the church because we don't do hymns. And again, that's okay because it's not going to change. Because I want, and the hymns are awesome.
Yeah.
They're fabulous, and I would love us to do some. That's not the point. The point is this. The point is, it's not about me getting ministered to a church. It's not about you getting ministered to. It's that first-time visitor that comes through the door.
Yes.
Again.
Yeah. It's more important to them that they hear the gospel message in a song. Because most people, the first, five, 7 minutes, they're already checked out if they're not a believer. They're just like, oh, this is just like any other place. Or I don't know, what do they want from me? Or something like that. But when they hear the name Jesus said, see, everybody, demons,
yeah,
believers, unbelievers, angels, when the name of Jesus is spoken,
yeah,
it gets our attention.
Yeah.
All right? We want to get people's attention. And it has nothing to do with our strength and power. It's all about His. We also sang at the end there, we sing, Christ is enough. Look at the chorus there. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need The Y is capitalized. It's in you. Again, I'm not Father God, Jesus the Son, Holy Spirit. He's a triune God, but God set it up this way. Everything's through Jesus. And then we'd send that song. Everything I need. The capital Y, the U, it's talking about Jesus. Christ. He's enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Amen? Powerful lyrics. Some people walked in today, you might not have known that. There might be some in this room today, which is awesome, that you didn't know Jesus makes all the difference in the world. You might not have realized that it's one thing to love God, but it's another thing to accept his son Jesus, because that's his plan. That's his plan. It's just the way he laid it out, you know? That's why you'll notice always the preaching, the sermons, we always end with an opportunity to say, you know what, I realize I need Jesus. This, and, you know, our kids are doing this right now. At the end of the service today, one of the kids in there will do a prayer to have somebody, if somebody wants to make a commitment to Jesus. I mean, that's what it's about, people. All right? It's about commitments to Christ. It's about change. It really is about that. Again, so it's a little uncomfortable. It's not exactly what I want, but are we reaching people for Jesus? That's what I want to be a part of, all right? Let's take a moment and look at Peter. He was writing various churches and experiencing all kinds of persecution. And he shares what it means to be a chosen people of God. He says in 2 Peter 2, verse 4, he says, "You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple." Okay, talk about uncomfortable and unwanted. He was rejected by people. But he was chosen by God for great honor. Now, let's continue with verse 5 and see what we're supposed to learn through this. And you, who's the you? Yes. It's us, right? He's speaking to the church. He's speaking to us. You are living stones that God is building in his spirit, to a spiritual temple. What's more, he goes on to say, he says, not only are you just living stones, but every person, when you accept Jesus, he says, you're a holy priest. And then this is what's really something, and this is what I was pondering on, thinking about. Well, if I'm a priest, then I want everything taken care of. I'm thinking, oh, I'm the priest, I'm the priest of this house, I want everything taken care of for me, and I want, no, that's not. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, we do something. We offer spiritual, I don't like that word, sacrifice. Sacrifice means exactly that. It's uncomfortable. Yeah. It's not always pleasant. God's saying, if you want to represent me, you're going to have to go through some tough times. You're going to have to go through some areas of sacrifice. And it doesn't just happen once. It's our entire Christian journey. Amen? And it says something. It pleases God. Now, does God get great joy when you're hurting and suffering? No, but he gets great joy when he sees the growth in us.
Amen.
He knows what his word says, because he wrote it. He knows what it's going to produce in us. What if we knew that? Woohoo! Lord! Bring it on! Don't say they'll bring it on, because he'll try and trick you up, but the Lord will take you through a situation, and the Bible says that he won't let you go through more than you can handle. What he's talking about is it's going to be more than you can handle, but he's going to take you. You know what I mean? The Lord is going to, you're going to go through some tough things, and you say, Lord, bring it on. Lord, I want to be a believer. I want to be sold out to you. I want to go after everything you want. And the Lord says, okay, there's going to be some tough times, but no worries. I'm right here with you.
Right.
I'm going to walk you through it. I'm going to walk you through it. It's amazing. First Peter 2:9 says this, but you're not like that. You're a chosen people. Royal priests. A holy nation. God's very own possession. I think this is scripture in something like King James said, you're a peculiar people. I am. And he says, but because of this, he says, you can show others the goodness of God. It doesn't say because of this, you'll just have everything to be so good in church. Because of this, everything's going to work out. You'll have no relationship troubles or anything like that. No, he says, because of this, you're going to go through sacrifice. Because of this, there's going to be things that are going to produce endurance. And you have to persevere and produce endurance and develop character. Because of this, people are going to have hope. They're going to see this in you.
Amen.
You are the church, people. We are the living sacrifice of God. When people look at us, we want to just reflect Jesus. Have people ever heard you say the name Jesus? God reflected. Not always just say it. Sometimes you act it too. I'm just saying, come on, people. It's Jesus. Yeah. Saying the name of Jesus is uncomfortable, but it's always worth it.
Yes, it is.
Let's just talk about here. You know, it can be uncomfortable to greet people at the door or the parking lot if you're not that type of person that's real outgoing. It can be uncomfortable. We got a couple people here. It's our first time here. It can be uncomfortable coming into a situation where we all know each other. It can be uncomfortable for people. It can be uncomfortable to sit by someone you don't know very well. Because I know you all too well. I can almost guarantee about 70% of you, I can tell you where you will sit before you sit here. Because you're in the same spot every week. There's a few of you that always move around. And I can tell you those people too. Again, it's uncomfortable. For some people, it's uncomfortable to sit in the same seat. I can tell it bothers you, so you move around. For other people, this is my comfort zone. You grab your seats, you're there, you put your stuff down, and it's just who we are. It can be uncomfortable to leave a small group. Oh, you mean I gotta open my house up? Oh, you mean I gotta meet someone at Starbucks? Oh, you mean I gotta have a sense of responsibility? Yep. It can be uncomfortable to serve in the children's ministry. Because, you know, I'm on a schedule, if I'm not there, they call me, and I've got to show up on time. I actually have to prepare a little bit.
There you go.
Living sacrifices, people. We are living sacrifices. Because we care about more a young child coming in than if I have my own personal time for watching TV. I may have to take an hour and study a lesson that week. But maybe there'll be a child coming in for the very first time that doesn't know Jesus.
Yeah.
Lord, you'll use me. Oh, well, I'm just a greeter. Well, maybe that smile you have at the door that made them comfortable so that they will come down and relax and be open to the Word.
Yeah,
one day in heaven, the Lord will show you. I think it's going to be on, I don't know if it'll be on video. I don't know if it'll be projected in the sky for us. He's going to show us all these encounters. I know He is. I'm confident in it. I'm confident in that, all right? Oh, boy. All right, so. Church. My perfect church starts on time, ends on time. So we're going to wrap it up here, and we'll continue this next week. Go ahead and close your notes up. Have I got you peaked and get you excited about this?
Yes.
All right, good, good, good. That's important. That's important. So, Father God, I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, in this body, Lord, that you put together. Lord, that we know sometimes you're taking pastor through some uncomfortable things. We know you are also letting the rest of us go through some uncomfortable things. And so, Father, now in Jesus' name, I speak peace on every person in this room. I thank you, Father, that their hearts and minds are open to this day forward of seeing uncomfortableness as something different. Uncomfortableness is something that can allow your love to pour through us. And Father, I thank you that none of these people in this room have that give up attitude, Lord, that they're listening to like that coach I was telling you about, Peyton's coach. They're listening saying, keep up the battle. Keep going strong. This is going to make us better than before. Again, not to make us these great people, Lord, but people to do your will and purpose through our life. So, Father, just as an act of our will, as we're sitting here, Lord, we surrender uncomfortableness to you. We surrender to you, and we ask the Holy Spirit that you would just fill us with your love, and show us through this series how to express it to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We're doing one last thing. Don't stand up yet, but go ahead and put your eyes up front. Let me get this one last scripture up there. It's found in Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. Part of the thing about being uncomfortable, it's God's plan from the very beginning when you accept Jesus. It says there in Romans 10, it says, for it's by believing in your heart that you are made right with God. All right, first of all, to be a believer, you've got to believe in your heart.
Yeah.
And that means deep inside, spiritually. It's just like, Lord, I'm tired of going my own way. And it says something, you got to do something uncomfortable. It says, You're made right with God, and it is by doing something. Openly declaring your faith in God that you're saved. And so I just want to encourage us. I'm gonna do a couple things here. I'm just gonna pray over you. I'm gonna ask in here today, we're all friends, we're all family. Is there anybody in this room at this moment that say, you know what? I've never openly declared that Jesus is my Lord, and I want to do that with everybody else. We're all going to pray together. Is anybody here today that would be willing and bold enough to say, I've never said, Jesus, come into my life, and I need to do that today? Thank you, Lord. All right. Let's do this together. Just repeat after me. Father God, I thank you for Jesus. I believe in my heart. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving me of my sins. And I openly declare that Jesus, you are my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all get a little uncomfortable and stand up right where we are, all right? Go ahead and stand where you are. Worship team's going to come up. We're not done. We're just about done, but not totally done. So what I want you to do is take out your connection card. If you made any sort of decision for Christ, mark that on there. If you have an offering or a tithe for us, fill out the envelope. And here's what's also super important. We're going to worship together with one last song. Maybe you're uncomfortable worshiping Him. Just do something different today. Just be a little uncomfortable. Lift your hands. Sing a little louder.
Sing a little lower.
Whatever you need to do. Just to stretch yourself a little bit. And at that same time, if there's anybody here today that needs prayer, I mean any kind of prayer, a small amount, a big amount. Maybe you've never walked up for prayer, or maybe you walk up every week and you think, oh, they're probably tired of it. No, they're not. I have prayer partners walking up front to either side. What I want you to do is just get out of your seats while worshiping and just go up to those partners. Tell them what you have need of. Say, I'm uncomfortable telling this to you, but I need to share with you this need in my life or that need or a concern for something. And let them just love you. Let God use them to let uncomfortableness bring out love. Amen? Can you do that for me? All right, we'll start worshiping together. Walk up front, ushers, receive the offering. I'll be back in just a second to close up. Let's worship.
To the one who has saved us all, I say.
joining us today, Father. We stand in awe of you, Lord. Father, thank you for bringing us today together on this Memorial Weekend. As Miss Cindy led us in prayer earlier, for those of us that have loved ones or know family members or friends who have lost people in active service, Father, Lord, we just pray for the comfort of the Holy Spirit. It's also a time when many of us are thinking of our own personal lives, our lost loved ones, parents, family members, Father. Lord, thank you for comforting us with the Holy Spirit. As we go forth today, Lord, we go forth, Lord, knowing, Lord, you've kind of opened this up for us. We're probably going to get uncomfortable a few times. And Lord, we look for opportunity for you to speak to us this week, Lord, and for be able to let your love flow through us. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. God bless you guys. Have a great week. It's good to be together. Growth Track Step 4 in the Fireside Room at noon. Otherwise,